Good morning and welcome to worship this morning. We have a very, very busy Sunday morning this morning. We'll be installing new members. We will be installing the call committee for the church. So there'll be some unusual activities that occur in the services today. Just a quick reminder, the offering plate's in the back. We do need lectors for weekly services. If you'd like to be a lector, there's a sign-up sheet in the narthex. The flowers, sign up for the altar flowers in the back. The flowers today are given by Nathan and Barbara Rubik, our newlywed couple. And it's an honor of the Redeemer family. So welcome and thank you very much, Barbara and Nick. As you know, next Sunday, August 1st, is our rally Sunday. So please call members that you know that you haven't seen for a while and invite them to Rally Sunday. There will be activities, there will be a meal following the service, and the service is at 10 o'clock. So please make a note that we'll start have our service on the 1st at 10 o'clock. The new members today that we're welcoming are Ed and Lois Engel and Pastor Steve Schulte. We need your voice for the choir, so if you're a singer, you don't have to have talent, but as long as you can carry a tune. We'll start choir August the 11th. We have a warm-up period at 6:30, and we'll actually start practice at 7. So please sign up for a choir if you're interested in singing. What else we got? Okay, as you notice, we have the coffee hour again. Don Gall has graciously appointed to be the one, according to the Bible, he brews the coffee. So please thank Don for his work on the coffee hour. If you'd like to bring in a special treat to share with the congregation, please do so. If you notice, our food pantry was empty. We carried a lot of food over to the YMCA. They packed boxes for families that need food, and they had run out of food. So Carol Gurley took a whole carload of our groceries over there to help them out some, to help feed families that need food. So, you know, please remember to bring in a canned good or two each Sunday and put it in the pantry for people who need their food. With that being said, Pastor.
Please stand for the first hymn.
morning in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Let us come before God in confession. To you, O God, we lift up our souls. You know us through and through. We confess our sins to you. Remember not our sins. Remember us with your steadfast love. Show us your ways. Teach us your paths. And lead us in justice and truth. For the sake of your goodness, in Jesus Christ our Savior. Amen. Children of God, come with joy and draw water from the well of salvation. Remember the gift of baptism. Your sin is washed away in the name of Jesus. You belong to Christ. You are anointed to serve. Raise your heads. The reign of God is near.
Amen.
And now may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Gracious God, you've placed within the hearts of all your children a longing for your word and a hunger for your truth. Grant that we may know your Son to be the true bread from heaven, and share this bread with all the world, through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord.
Amen.
May be seated. At this time, I invite Ed, Lois Engel, and Steve Schulte to come forward, please. And stand right here, any place you like that. Okay. Our help is in the name of the Lord, who made heaven and earth. May the Lord be with the three of you and also with this congregation. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you've called us to the fellowship of the gospel and bind us in love, brotherhood, and service in your holy church. And we humbly pray that those who are this day united with us and we with them may be one in you. Grant that we may together grow in grace, be fruitful in every good work, and endeavor to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace, that at the day of Christ we may be welcomed in the church triumphant, there ever to glorify you with your Son in the unity of the Holy Spirit. Amen. This time I'm going to ask you, the three of you, do you promise to abide in the faith of what we say in the Apostles' Creed on Sunday morning and in the covenant of your baptism, and as a member of this church to be diligent in the use of means of grace and in prayer? If so, answer, I do by the help of God.
I do by the help of God.
The blessing of Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be with each and every one of you. Amen. Now, if you'll turn around, I'm going to introduce you, okay? All right. We'll start over here. This is Ed and Lois Engel. They came down from, let's see, your last stop was Michigan for here? That's correct. And Steve Schulte. And Steve's last stop before coming here was Thunderbolt, right? Okay. That's what I said. So anyway, tell me, give them a big warm welcome. Let's do it. I'm going to have them come out when I come out, follow me out, and give you an opportunity to say hello. If you know them, say hello again. If you don't know them, introduce yourself, and we'll do that. We got a picture being taken here.
Yes, sir. Come and look at me for just a
minute. Okay, sorry. I think she's done. So we're done.
She's fine.
Okay. Go ahead. Thanks for coming. Welcome. Jim Trennan, if you come forward, please.
If the following members are present, please come forward. There's Sandy Postal, Heidi Wagstaff, Amanda Kaltenberg, Chris Thompson, Megan Maynard, and I don't believe Greg's here today. He had business, so in absentia would be Greg Anderson.
You'll just kind of line up across here.
These people have been elected and voted on by the council as your call committee as we search for our new pastor. We tried to get a good representation of all the church, and I think the council was very pleased with the people that were nominated, and they were elected unanimously and as a member of the call committee.
Okay, if you'll turn and face me, please, this time. You've been appointed to serve on the call committee of Redeemer Lutheran Church. In baptism, we were welcomed into the body of Christ and sent to share in the mission of the church. At this point, we rejoice that you have been carefully and prayerfully asked to help seek a pastor, to recommend to the congregation will be called to lead this congregation as it fulfills God's mission here on earth. First, I want to give you a reading from 1 Corinthians. There are varieties of gifts, but the same Spirit. There are varieties of service, but the same Lord. And there are varieties of activities, but it's the same God who is active in every one of them. To each is given the manifestation of the Spirit for the common good. You've been appointed to serve on this call committee by the same Spirit. There's a variety of leadership and trust that was given to you. You'll lead this congregation in discovering the trends, the challenges, the opportunities, and the resources that we have in this community, and in clarifying this congregation's mission, in identifying the gifts of ministry that are needed for the pastoral leadership of this congregation, and in selecting a candidate to recommend to the congregation for call. So on behalf of your sisters and brothers in Christ, I ask you, will you accept and faithfully carry out the duties of this office to recommend to the congregation for call? If so, answer, I will, and I ask God to help me.
I will, and I ask God to help me.
And to those of you in the congregation, people of God, I ask you, will you support this call committee, the members and their work? Will you hold them, the Congregational Council, and the office of the bishop in prayer as they work together to discern who God is calling as the next pastor of Redeemer Lutheran Church? If so, answer, we will, and we ask God to help us.
We will, and we ask God to help us.
I now declare that you as a group have been installed as a call committee of this congregation. May Almighty God bless you and direct your days and your deeds in peace, that you may be faithful servants of Christ. Amen. Thank you very much. Thank you. Are you ready to help me again? You gonna help me? Okay, got it? Here we go. Now we're gonna start off with a hard question. It may take you a second to think about it. Oh, we got kids? Come on up. Wow. Go ahead. I'm sorry. Didn't see you. Have a seat. Comfortable seat, okay? Come on, over and sit down. That's good. Alright. So I'm gonna ask you, and then I'm gonna ask you guys some too, but they can answer a lot of my questions. Alright? Ready? How many of you, and you can raise your hand too if this works, how many of you came to church today? Some of you didn't. So you came to church today. Now, I'm going to ask this question. This is a little harder. Do you like coming to church? Okay, now, what are some things you like about church? Getting together, some fellowship, okay, that's a fancy term, but getting together and talking to each other and smiling and laughing, and right? That's good, fellowship. Anything else? Praying? Praying, that's good too, I like that. Anybody else? No. Being closer to God, coming in and do that. Anybody out there got any ideas why you like coming to church?
See the pastor.
I like that. See the pastor. That's a good idea. Autographs afterwards. All right, we'll have. Here's some ideas I came up with, okay? And you mentioned some of them, but I'm going to expand on them just a little bit. Mary's back there playing piano and sings and leads us in music. This is a chance to sing and sing songs of praise to God. A different way than we normally do, to thank God for what He's done for us. We also pray. We pray to God. Sometimes we pray to thank Him. Sometimes we pray for help. Sometimes we pray for guidance, but He gives us a chance to pray. He gives us a chance to learn about God and Jesus through the lessons, through the preaching, and through educational classes. He gives us a chance to talk to God about how we can help other people. But one of the things I like you said at the very beginning is it gets us together to talk to each other. And the reason I like that is because that's a very important part of church. As we come into church on Sunday morning, it reminds us that many others believe the same way we do. And many others have to go out in the world the same way we do. And so we can share our faith on Sunday morning just by being here, just by smiling at each other, and just by saying, how are things going? Being together is fun, and it's good for us. Help me pray. Dear God, we thank you for the church.
We thank you for the church.
We thank you for the opportunity to pray.
We thank you for the opportunity to pray.
To sing and to learn.
To sing and to learn.
And to reach out to others.
To reach out to others.
Amen.
Amen.
Thanks for coming up. Appreciate it.
We have been rooted and grounded in the love of Christ, which surpasses all human knowledge. Because Christ dwells in our hearts, our lives are continuously strengthened and empowered by the ongoing presence of the Spirit. The New Testament reading today is Ephesians 3:14-21. For this reason, I bow my knees before the Father, from whom every family in heaven and on earth takes its name. I pray that according to the riches of his glory, he may grant that you may be strengthened in your inner being with power through his Spirit, and that Christ may dwell in your hearts through faith as you are being rooted and grounded in love. I pray that you may have the power to comprehend with all the saints what is the breadth and length and height and depth, and to know the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge, so that you may be filled with all the fullness of God. Now to him who by the power at work within us is able to accomplish abundantly far more than all we can ask or imagine, to him be the glory in the church and in Christ Jesus to all generations, forever and ever. Amen.
Please stand. The Gospel according to John, the 6th chapter.
Glory to you, Lord.
In John's Gospel, the miracles of Jesus are called signs because they reveal the true character of God. As such, they remain within the mystery of God and can't be brought under human control. The Gospel of John tells us that Jesus went to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, also called the Sea of Tiberias. A large crowd kept following him because they saw the signs that he was doing for the sick. And Jesus went up the mountain and sat down with his disciples. Now the Passover, the festival of the Jews, was near. And when he looked up and saw a large crowd coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread for these people to eat?" And he said this to test him, for he himself knew what he was going to do. And Philip answered him, "6 months' wages wouldn't buy enough bread for each of them to even get a little." And one of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a little boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what are they among so many?" And Jesus said, "You make the people sit down." Now there was a great deal of grass in the place, so they sat down, about 5,000 in all. And then Jesus took up the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them who were seated, and also the fish, as much as they wanted. And when they were satisfied, he told the disciples, "You gather up the fragments left over, so that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up, and from the fragments of the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten, they filled 12 baskets. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they began to say, "This is indeed the prophet who has come into the world." And when Jesus realized that they were about to come and take him by force to make him a king, he withdrew again to the mountain by himself. And when evening came, his disciples went down to the sea and got into a boat and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come. The sea became rough because of the strong wind blowing. And when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat. They were terrified. But he said to them, "It is I, don't be afraid." And then they wanted to take him into the boat. And immediately the boat reached the light before it was their boat. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Exceeded. Let's bow our head for a moment of silence prayer. Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, we give you thanks for the opportunity of being able to worship together here this morning. And now may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight, O God, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Well, they've been gathering here for about 2 or 3 days now. There were moms and dads, there were children and grandparents, there were people in all shapes and sizes from all walks of life just gathering downstairs. And they really had nothing in common except one thing. That was, they came to see this Christ. To see and maybe even just to touch him. They wanted to see the man who turned water into wine. They wanted to see the man who talked openly with women of questionable character. They wanted to see the man that cured diseases. They wanted to see the man who even claimed to be from God. Out there on the hillside that day, it was kind of like a 3-ring circus. It was all 3 rings and then maybe even a few more wrapped up in one man. Just one man, Jesus Christ. It was about the 3rd day they gathered out there, and the crowd became very large. What had happened was Jesus had just lost his cousin. His cousin was beheaded, John the Baptist. And Jesus wanted to get away and kind of think about it and meditate, decide what was going to happen next. And so he and his disciples left, but the people heard where he was, and they followed him. And more people came on the scene. This is the only gospel that's in, this is the only miracle that's listed in all 4 gospels. Matthew says that there were 5,000 people. Luke, Mark says there's 5,000 people, but Matthew adds that there's 5,000 people, not counting women and children. That's how come you sometimes hear a higher number, 8,000 to 10,000. But as the 3rd day, were on, several thousand people had gathered together. They became a very hungry crowd. I don't know if you're familiar with the term hangry. You know, that's anger and hunger. You don't want to be around one of those people. I mean, trust me, life experience, you don't want to be around one. But anyway, the disciples were getting scared. They were a little bit worried about some hangry people out there. And as they looked around, there was not even one McDonald's or Burger King or Crystal or Wendy's anywhere in sight. Okay? And the disciples were really getting a little bit nervous about this whole thing. This is a faith lesson, friends. This is a faith lesson. It tells us that, and get this straight, because we sometimes ignore the issue. There's always going to be a need or some needs in our world. Always. And it's our job, our responsibility, our duty, our obligation to respond to those needs. And do it the way that Jesus would do it. And that's what this story is about. We're not supposed to do it like society does it. We're not supposed to do it in such a way that we're going to take the easy way out and not help anybody. We're not to measure our effectiveness by the size of our resources. Because with God's help, we can do a lot more than we think we can. We need to acknowledge, and this is tough to do. We need to acknowledge that God is the source of all of our blessings. Not your hard work, not pulling yourself up by your bootstrap. Not your inheritance, nothing like that. All your blessings come from God. We tend to forget that sometimes. Our faith is to believe that God understands the needs of this world and responds through our faith, responds through our work, responds through our response to people. And when we follow God, it's going to be like this lesson today. There's always going to be more than enough. This lesson shows us 3 things right off the top as we go through life. It shows us that it's important to bring our problems and our concerns to God, knowing that God's in control. Our problems aren't going to go away. Nobody's going to promise you that. They're not going to go away. But we should acknowledge that God can deal with them. I've told you before that I had a sign in my office. It says, God, help me remember that nothing is going to happen to me today that you and I can't handle. Another thing we learned from the lesson is we're going to be surprised that God's going to use our meager resources in ways that we can't even dream about. If we just are willing to let him do it. We need to remember that when God acts, he acts liberally. In the lesson today, Jesus was traveling by boat. Incidentally, as I said, this is only one mention in all four Gospels. Those people out there, I want you to imagine several thousand people, right? There were various reasons that they were there. Some of them were honest believers. Some were followers of John that were now confused about what to do next, so they went to his cousin. Some were curiosity seekers. They wanted to see maybe a few miracles or magic tricks or whatever you want to call it. Some were skeptics about this Jesus. Some were the scribes and Pharisees that were trying to find a way to, I used to call them a hit squad, Pharisees trying to discredit it. And of course, there were some people that were blind, handicapped, and sick. And there were the young, and there were the old, and there were the infants in arms out there that day. And people still seek Jesus for the same reason. Church pews have people in that are looking for those same things today. But let's forget about the miracle workers for just a second. Seekers and those. What about the honest seekers, those that wanted God? Where else are they going to turn? Those that had just lost John as their leader were turning to Christ because he was the answer. But we learned the hard way out in society, guys. If you haven't yet, you haven't lived. It's hard to trust God in Jesus Christ. It's hard to let go and let God take care of my life. It's hard to let God handle the situation that you're involved in personally. It's one thing to say, I'll pray for you. It's another to say, I'm going to pray for myself and let God take charge. It's hard to believe that God has a better idea than I do, isn't it? In the gospel, it says that Jesus had compassion on his people. Can you imagine looking out at this hangry group of people out there and have compassion on them? He had compassion because of his love of people, something that some of us lack. In the crowd was an unfolding of all kinds of mankind. There were some people out there who had been very successful, and there were some people that just were failures in life. There were some people whose lives have been ruined by sin and mistakes. There were people living that he was looking at eyeball to eyeball. There were people out there living with misery and pain and problems and suffering and agony and loneliness and despair. Sound like anybody you know? And yet Jesus had a compassion. He looked out on those people that day in a way that you and I don't normally look at people. His compassion embraces all of mankind, you see. For Jesus, there was no one beyond hope. For Jesus, there was no one who had drifted too far away from God. For Jesus, there was nobody that had done too many things wrong. For Jesus, there was no one who didn't need some help in life. There's a big difference between the way Jesus thinks and treats people and the way that we do. His concern with the nameless multitude that day is quite obvious. Yet we often turn our backs on other people and shrug our shoulders and say, I don't want to take care of themselves. I'll tell you a little thing. You're members of this congregation, most of you are. We're part of the ELCA. And one of the things we do in a great way is help people overseas, missionaries out. Yet, do you realize that millions of people die each year without knowing the story of Jesus? Millions of people never heard the story of Jesus, or never heard it in a way that it affected them, and they die. And yet, the ELC has had to cut back in missionaries. When I started seminary, that was a long, long time ago, but we did have a lecture for those of you that wonder. Anyway, there were about several hundred missionaries overseas when I started seminary. Today we have about 70. It was closer to 1,000 back then, it's 70 now, because there's just not enough money coming in to support it. We hear about hundreds of thousands of people suffering because of war overseas and dying in torn countries because of the misery. And yet what happens to their souls because we didn't have the funds to go out and teach the message of Jesus Christ and preach it? You know that millions of people die every year, hundreds of thousands die every year from hunger. And yet many people haven't even contributed the amount you pay for a Big Mac for the cause of world hunger. That's what it means to turn our backs. That's what it means to shrug our shoulders. Nothing obvious, it's just the way we live our life. We're to bear the name of Christ and share his concerns in his way. We're willing to accept as long as somebody else does the work. As long as somebody else puts in the money, we're willing to take the credit. What kind of job are we doing following Christ's style of compassion as individuals or as a congregation? As we look around at the problems of the world, you know, there's drugs and crime and alcohol and suffering and misery and loneliness. And does that bother you? Or are those just second-class citizens that got what they had coming? Good thing Jesus didn't feel that way, okay? At sundown that day, the disciples of the day felt like we think. They said, hey, this is a debt to talking to Jesus. At first, they really liked it. All these crowds of Jesus, and they were walking around saying, I'm with Jesus. I'm one of the disciples. They liked that. But now they're getting angry. They're getting a little excited. So they walk up to Jesus, and they said, this is a desert place. Let's just send them away so they can find someplace to eat. That was a problem, but the best thing they could come up with was send them away. We don't want to bother with them. Not our problem. But Jesus looked at them and said, where are we going to buy enough bread to feed these people? You notice, it doesn't leave room to say it's none of his business. He could have said, man, these irresponsible people, they have to learn to be self-reliant. Let them go. Or these people are irresponsible by not coming with some extra food and stuff, or they don't deserve my help. But he didn't judge. He just simply said, where can we buy bread that they can eat? He could have offered a dozen lame excuses, sent them off, like we do in our daily life, or why we don't have time or effort or money to help somebody in need. But he didn't do that, you see. He did say, and notice this, he said, where are we going to buy the bread? Uh-oh. The disciples catch on pretty fast that they're in it together. At least he didn't say, where are you going to buy the bread? He said, where are we going to buy the bread? Christ identified himself out there with the problems of the people. The suffering of humanity, that's his suffering. The hunger of humanity, that's his hunger. The pain of humanity, that's his pain. Alone that day, the disciples would have been totally helpless. But when Christ comes into the picture and says we, it changes everything. There's no limit to what we can do if the we is Christ and us together. Anyway, Philip comes up to Jesus and says, look, what do you mean, what are we going to do to buy bread? It's going to take at least 200 coins to feed each one, even a little. You see, as human beings, we kind of lack vision. Although I understand where Philip was coming from, it didn't look good. We let sin take over. We become unimaginative. We're a small group. How can we do those things? Where the money going to come from? Where is the manpower going to come from? There's no use even trying. But Philip was a practical man, just a little short in faith and trust. But then came Andrew. You know, that's Simon Peter's brother. Andrew had originally been a follower of John the Baptist. And Andrew looks at Jesus and says, there's a kid out here with a picnic lunch. He has five loaves of bread and two fish. And actually, there were probably two barley loaves. That's the cheapest kind of bread, if you're interested in knowing that. And two fish. Probably, based on what people did back then, there were two pickled sardines in there. Okay? There were 5,000 to 10,000 people with two pickled sardines and the cheapest bread they got. And then Andrew was a little practical, though. He says, well, I don't think that's really going to help in this situation. But he had enough faith to try. But here's the catch, guys. And this goes for your life, too. It was enough. Because Christ's power transcends all human limitations. He took what he had, and it was enough, with plenty left over. The Bible text says we can't ignore in our Christian faith. And say, well, what difference can one person make? Well, how does our congregation help with a problem that big? We can't do that. The answer comes straight from Jesus. He said, whatever you have, you bring it to me. Bring it to me. Let me bless it. Let me pray over it. Bring it to me. And it's going to make a world of difference. So Jesus took that little picnic lunch, fed over 5,000 people, and their 12 baskets of food left over. After all, you know, think about it. God created those fish in the first place. God created the things that made that bread in the first place. So why is it so hard? Why is it so hard for you to accept the fact that God could recreate them into something even better? God created you in the first place. Why would it be so hard for Him to recreate us? What is it that holds us back? Well, today the world is still full of people seeking the Word of God. People are still hurting. People are still in misery. People still have loneliness. People are still hungry. People still haven't heard the Word of God. So it's up to us. The critical truth in this is that God needs what we have. If we'll bring what we have to God and trust Him with it, He can make a world of difference. The disciples found out that day that the we, Christ and me, can change the world. Amen. Please stand for the next hymn. Confess our faith in the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, He rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Rooted in Christ and sustained by the Spirit, we offer our prayers for the Church, the world, and all creation.
We pray for the Church. Bless the ministries of our neighboring congregations. Empower churches throughout the world and encourage missionaries who accompany global neighbors. Kindle in us a spirit of collaboration that all people may know your loving works. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for creation. Send rain to lands experiencing drought and come to the aid of those enduring sweltering heat. Nurture wheat and barley crops grown for the nourishment of your people and conserve aquatic habitats and fish populations. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for those who govern. Cast out arrogance, selfishness, and corruption, and instruct those who lead to practice compassion and humility. Inspire them with a vision of the common good and a commitment to ensure that all who hunger are fed. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for those bowed down by heavy burdens, those who are unemployed or underemployed, those unable to find affordable housing, and those without health insurance. Console those who grieve and hear the cry of those who call to you for healing, especially those on our prayer list. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We pray for this congregation. Deepen our desire to use what we have to serve those in need. When we worry that we do not have enough resources for ministry, assure us of your abundance. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We give thanks for those who have entered the church eternal, as you sustain them through all their days. So dwell in our hearts that we may have the power to comprehend with all the saints the love of Christ that surpasses knowledge. Hear us, O God.
Your mercy is great.
We ask you to look after all those on the prayer list and also for Billy and Alana, Cindy, for Emily, Grace, Aaron, and Jason, for Charles, for Brittany and her unborn twins. We lift these and all our prayers up to you, O God, confident in the promise of your love, of your Savior, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. The peace of the Lord be with you always.
And also with you.
The night in which he was betrayed, our Lord Jesus Christ took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it, gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take and eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do for the remembrance of me." Then again, in the same manner, after supper, he took the cup of wine. When he had given thanks, he gave it to them and said, "Drink this, all. This is the new blood of the new covenant, which is shed for you and for many for the remission of sins. Whenever you drink it, do this for the remembrance of me." Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen."
The body of Christ given for you. The blood of Christ shed for you. The body of our Lord Jesus Christ and his precious blood strengthened and preserved you unto eternal life. Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Thank you.
Go in peace and serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand.
Sunday morning, hallelujah, and it's lasting.